There's a woman who used to do junket interviews in a bed. That was her thing.
Yoko and John. With and people?
With people, with talent, yeah.
In the bed with them.
In a bed at the hotel at Four Seasons or whatever.
You know, that actually, without any naughtiness going on, I would prefer that too, to just lay in bed and have.
Just chat in bed.
Yeah, but people would be very disappointed.
Maybe a ball game
bed.
On? Or
yeah. No, just a little food maybe.
A little nosh. And you'll be happy.
If I never had to get out of bed for an interview or any kind of work, mm-hmm. Yeah. By the way, I write in bed.
Do you?
I do. I have one of these things that keep your lap from getting too hot from the laptop. I pull the laptop into bed. Uh-huh. And people are always shocked when I Skype with them because I'm in bed, even at 2 p.m. It's just because my back isn't so good. So if I lie, it's better than sitting up for me and writing, right? Because this gets, because I'm very old. So this is what I do.
How old are you, Phil?
How old do you think?
50.
That's nice of you.
You're older than 50?
51.
51. Okay, so that's not so much. For having done a TV show for a decade, that's...
Oh, yeah, you figured it out that way.
Well, but I mean, you that's actually pretty...
I
right
once
there.
Said to a college professor, he goes, how old would you say I am? I said, I honestly, you do not look a day over 70. He goes, well, that's pretty good. I'm 60.
I always tell people I'm older than I am because that way I'm, you know, in a good position.
Then you win.
Because otherwise I'm really old.
Yes.
But so when did you start show business stuff?
Oh, my goodness. When I was a little kid and I was trying to stay up late with my parents and their friends. I would imitate the Jackie Gleason show, the characters on the Jackie Gleason show, all in an effort to stay up late and maybe get a cookie, you know? And so if I imitated the characters, I found, you know, when you're a kid, you don't know that there's writing and directing and producing. You watch TV, way too much in my case, and you see the guys like on the Honeymooners and you go, oh, I love them, I want to be like them. Mm-hmm. And so I actually pursued that. So I was a big hit in college, a big hit in high school, and then you graduate and move into New York with a theater degree, and nobody seems to care that you're
so
a big hit in high school
and
college. College was great. It was Hofstra University on Long Island. I learned a hell of a lot.
I mean, you're a theater major?
Theater major. And their curriculum forces you to learn about theater from every side. Mm-hmm. So you have directing classes. You have writing, even, and play analysis, as well as the thing you're interested in, which in my case was acting. Mm-hmm. I thought I'll never use any of this other stuff because I'm going to be, you know, a great actor. So I tell everybody, if you're an actor, take a writing class. If you're a director, take an acting class. Mm-hmm. Learn about the thing from all the sides. I guess this applies to any field you want to go in. Yeah. You know, if you're an interviewer, why wouldn't you want to know about the other side of what you do?
Right.
And even, you know, the camera and the sound and all of it will help you be better at your chosen field.
Right.
So I feel like now, because I was a writer and a director and a producer for so many years, that if I ever did really go back to acting, I'd be unstoppable.
So did your parents like the idea of you going to Hofstra for acting?
No parent likes the idea of their kid
I guess that's
going
true.
To school for acting because they're smart. They know that when you get out, you now have a degree that's really good for nothing. Mm-hmm. You know, so go
they
into
get you
any
an audition or two.
Go into any theater anywhere that's making a show and say, "But here's my degree." They'll say, "Get out of here."
So did you do that in New York for years?
Years and years, and then some friends of mine wrote a show for ourselves to be in, and that became successful. And then at the same time, my friend Alan Kirschenbaum, who was already a writer, who I went to high school with, he came to my house with his blue metal box. This, he said, what is that? He goes, it's a word processor. It's 1987.
God.
Yes. And he goes, you and me, we're going to write a screenplay. I says, I don't know anything about writing a screenplay. You don't have to know anything. I know the structure, and you're funny, and we'll do it. I said, okay. We wrote it. We sold it. Our first thing. We sold it. Very encouraging. Now I had money in the bank. I went from being a 100-air to a 1,000-air. And I found when I was an actor, I ate tuna fish for dinner. And now as a writer, I could eat whatever I wanted, right? So this makes a big difference in your life. So I just, I started pursuing it because I wanted to eat. And here I am.
Did you like it? Did you feel like it was like a come down that you were?
No, I don't like writing. It's a pain in the ass.
So you don't like writing still?
No. Huh. Who does? It's like homework. You know that feeling in your gut when you're done with school and you got a mountain of homework to do mm-hmm. after that. It's like, it was enough already. I went to work all day. Now I have to write also mm-hmm. an essay, something, a script, whatever mm-hmm. it is. That feeling of that pit in your stomach, of this mountain ahead of you, mm-hmm. of work you have to do, never goes away. Now, when I'm in it,
right.
when I have a good idea, what I think is a good idea, mm-hmm. I do get excited. And it's fun to have written it and see it and, oh my God, I can't wait to show this to somebody. I hope they like it too.
Right.
Which is what writing is. You know, there's a famous quote, I hate writing, but love having written.
But you must have, there must have been a period where you were primarily writing. That was your primary gig. Yeah?
It still is.
Well, I mean, but you, when you're show running a show,
yes,
there's a lot of other
day.
Stuff going on
no,
also.
No, but you got to write every single right. day. Writer is still the main job of showrunner.
But there must have been a time where you had the responsibility of writing and not the responsibility of doing other things, or was there?
When you're trying to get into the business,
right.
all you're doing is writing spec scripts to see if somebody will take your stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And when you work on somebody else's show, of course, that is your only responsibility, is to write.
So was there any joy in that? Or was that also just like homework through that process?
When I'm in the room with the guys, you know, there's a writer's room mm-hmm. where we kind of go over each other's work and mm-hmm. come up with ideas for the show.
Mm.
Then each person will go off and hopefully write that script, come mm. back into the room, and then we all table it, meaning
right.
go over it again, start from page one, read through it. Can this line be better? Is this clear? Is this the... Being with the guys and the gals in that mm. room is the most fun on earth. I recommend it.
Mm.
To be in a writer's room with your friends and mm. to laugh every day. You're literally being paid to laugh every day. It actually is in the job description. Because what are we trying to do? We're trying to make each other laugh. If we
right.
can't make each other laugh in that room, how are we going to make America laugh?
Mm-hmm.
Right? So that's such a fun job. But mm. writing by myself, homework.
Mm. Even in bed.
Bed makes it a little better. but it really doesn't begin to compare with the group experience. It's like the difference between having friends and not having any friends.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah. So did you have to change your energy? Did you have to change your outset to become when you became a showrunner?
That's a great question. Yes. Because you go from being solitary.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, okay, I want to preface this by saying I'm the luckiest guy in the whole world, okay? But I went from being a writer by myself, writing mm-hmm. a script in my room alone. What should I call this? I asked my wife. She goes, I like when the brother says everybody loves Raymond. I think you should call it that. I said, okay, that's better than what I have, which is nothing. So thank you, Monica, for the title. Uh-huh. Ray hated it, by the way. Couldn't stand the title. Well, everybody loves, how would you like it if the name of the thing was everybody loves you? You would hate it. I said, I don't know if I would hate it. He goes, the pressure. So you go from that to one person at maybe the network who could like it or not like it. Hey, I like this. Show it to somebody else. Hey, I like this. The chances of that happening,
mm-hmm.
very small. Then for them to actually give you money to go cast it now. And I have a casting director. What do you mean? You're going to bring me actors, famous actors even, as if I'm somebody to mm-hmm. audition? But yeah, we're going to make a pilot. Wow. If you can cast it. Okay. Cast it. That's mm-hmm. a miracle. Make a pilot. That's a miracle. For them to pick it up. When they turn down many, many, many.
Mm-hmm.
Miracle. For the people to watch it once on TV and then to come back a second time. Miracle. And then I don't have to go on.
Mm-hmm.
Right? That's why we're here today.
Yeah.
Miracle upon miracle. All the planets lining up. Hitting the jackpot. Not once. Many, many, many times.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? With that comes at the moment they say, okay, your show's going on the air. You're now the boss of 150 people. What? Yes, this is now a multi-million dollar operation
mm-hmm.
because of what it costs to make these shows. You're in charge. I think I go back to bed, is the first reaction, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then you suddenly think, well, how am I going to do this? It's not how I'm going to do this. I understand because having worked on other shows, I know
right.
I kind of knew what the job was and I felt confident mm-hmm. because I was writing so personally and I was writing mm-hmm. about my family that I was probably the best person for this particular job, right?
Mm-hmm.
Of running this show. And yet, what will the tone be in the office? What will the tone be on the set?
Mm-hmm.
So you think, well, I've worked here. Who did I like? Who did I not like, really? Or who did I learn from? And what mm-hmm. did I learn not to do? And you know what it boiled down to for me? Be nice. Just be nice to everybody. Mm-hmm. Try to just make a nice, happy set. What is one of the most important things for making a happy set? The food. Mm-hmm. Bring in good food. Because nothing says you care about people, other than paying them nicely, than nice food on the set. Because what happens is, you're actually trying to make a family. Okay, we're doing a show about a family, and you want to make a family so that you're happy coming to work. And then the work is better. It's really simple. If you just have potato chips and crap out on the table,
right,
the crew guys come over, they grab their stuff, and they go back to work. But suddenly there's deli from New York is there, or you know, cinnamon buns from Chicago have come in. They're like, holy, did you taste this? This is, and right away they're talking, and it's about something nice. Something good in their day. And so this to me is everything.
And the expense of something like that compared to a show
you got
is nothing.
You got it.
But that's
you'd be surprised
thing.
How studios, networks sometimes nickel and dime you on this thing. This little thing. You know how we were talking about if you just had Splenda at the deli, it would actually make the difference because you like Splenda and that deli doesn't have it, so I'm going to this deli? Over a tiny thing like that. So imagine if food is fantastic. You know, we'd on show nights, we would bring in chefs from the outside, like the, you know, like they bring the food trucks now.
Right.
We were doing that years ago. Have the people come.
So when you came up through the system, or you were working for other people's, did things like, because you talk about in the movie, having a live audience.
Yes.
And how that's the kind of first fundamental
for
doing a show like this.
For me, it was. For me, it was. Because to me, the shows I valued were All in the Family, The Honeymooners, The Dick Van Dyke Show, Mary Tyler Moore, Taxi, The Odd Couple, Roseanne, The Cosby Show. From what they have in common? They all were filmed in front of a live audience, like theater. I studied theater. I like theater. I like when it's not all about the style of cutting. You know, now we're in the airport, now we're in the coffee shop, now we're in the bedroom, now we're in the living room, now we're in the bed. Wherever you are, all these images and costume changes and hairstyles are flashing in front of you. Right. I call it the illusion of entertainment. After 20 minutes, you saw so many things, you didn't have time to realize you weren't really entertained.
Right.
It was the illusion of entertainment. So, to me, I love the shows, like in All in the Family, when they just sat in the thing and they talked about important things that mattered. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily the political stuff or the social stuff that they got into, but the personal relationships that we all have. We never even had B stories on our show. You know what a B story is? That sub story that runs through, or the C story where this other character lost his shoe and that's running through the story, right?
Right.
We cut back to that, taking away from the main story. I figured if it was worth telling a story, it was worth telling it for 20 minutes. It's not a long time. And that you would be entertained by the content and the personalities and the psychology behind what was happening. You could actually sit and think and bring your own experience to it. You could relate to what was happening because there was something to relate to. That's the philosophy. Now, the audience, what that does is they provide a live event. So you're writing it like theater, you're performing it like theater, and it's being received as theater by a real audience. I'm not talking about canned laughter, which is anathema to me. It's fake. It's terrible. Which is how they do it all over the world, unfortunately, because it's cheaper. It's cheaper to do it the way the Russians wanted to do it, which is film a new episode every other day. By the way, this practice is now being done here in America on certain cable channels. It's cheap.
Thanks
and
after.
Easy. I guess so. And then they add canned laughter. And I don't know. I guess it's just like disposable. You know, it's just on and off. I really thought when we started, the show's for CBS, but in the back of my mind, this is going to be for Nick at Night. How many chances do you get to have something on television, right? To have your own TV show. So why not try to make it have lasting value? Why not try to make it as good as you could possibly make it? To emulate the shows that came before. Not imitate, but try to capture what they had. It's very important to me.
Well, it's a fascinating thing about the movie that the Russian, for me, the Russian experience of it after a while, and you obviously are going through all kinds of adventures in specific as you're going through this movie, but I got the sense that they just didn't have any place to learn. It's almost like they were in a technologically different place than we were in the 50s, but it's almost like they were just starting as though they were starting television in the 50s.
It's the Wild Wild West over there. Yeah. Or the Wild Wild East, right? Because yeah. they really didn't have sitcoms before 4 years ago, before The Nanny came over there from Sony, mm-hmm. and they translated and made it. They told me, you know, you got to see it to believe it. You have to go over and just observe. That was the original idea. Mm-hmm. Observe how they do it. Then come back and write a feature fictional film about a guy who goes over and have his show translated.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, okay, that could be good. But if the situation exists, the people really exist, why not bring a camera crew over and film what really happens?
Mm-hmm.
And the head of Sony said, I love that idea. Would you be the guy?
Mm.
So like a moron, I said, yes, because then I had to go. But what I found was they came from soap operas to work on sitcoms. Mm-hmm. Why soap operas, I said. But they're also a half hour.
But it feels like that. It feels like they're making soap operas. It feels like they're doing the Raymond script. I mean, you have probably actually, a couple of the actors, like they're just acting like they're in a soap.
It's actually the style
yeah.
that they're used to. Of filming an episode every other day, just like a soap opera. Mm-hmm. And by the way, when a sitcom hits over there, they run it every night.
God.
Monday to Friday, like a soap opera.
So that's why they say at the end of the movie, don't want to give away the end.
Yeah, don't want to give away the end.
But
I don't want to say that because that's all I have in the movie is this going to work or not?
But
right?
It's the journey. No, well, I think it's the journey. I think the journey, I mean, the reason the movie's fun is because of the journey. But
yes, but I'd rather not say it. Okay. It's okay with you.
So, but okay. Yeah. So the movie.
But what we could say is if it was a hit.
Right.
They would order many episodes.
Yeah. So and they that's five anyway. Nights a week?
And they would run it 5 nights. That's what they do with The Nanny. That's what they do with Married with Children.
So in some ways, that's a whole... one of the stories in the movie is about a guy who can't get out of his day job, basically to do your show,
yeah.
their show, a yeah. version of your show.
Right.
But it makes... that actually makes more sense because he really could never do stage and... You know, he couldn't do 3 nights on stage and work 3 nights... taping at a sitcom.
He could, because the sitcom tapes during the day, and they tape around. By the way, all those people have theater jobs. Huh. They all have theater jobs. They were let out by their theater people. This guy would not be let out by his theater person.
Hmm. So really the only way to make a living in Russia up until now was doing theater.
Here's what happens. If you're an actor in Russia, in Moscow, you join a theater company. That is just what you do. The theater master then owns you. Runs your life. You want to do TV and movies with his permission. That's it. Very different from here. Although maybe you could go back to the 30s and 40s in the studio system. Right. That probably was the same.
So you might have been happier coming out of Hofstra going to Russia.
By the way, I'm sitting there. I'm in Hofstra. What are you learning about? Stanislavski, Chekhov, the Moscow Art Theater, and oh my God, 30 years later, I'm standing there with the guy. That was kind of trippy. You know, it was weird. I didn't like what he said to me, but it was very cool. I'm standing on the stage at the Moscow Art Theater. From what I studied and where I came from, that was actually, you know, it's a little emotional.
Well, it does put perspective on the whole thing. And I mean, I think Raymond is so, and you clearly are so affected by the history of sitcoms. It's so steeped in that rich history, and then to go somewhere where there is no history.
Yes.
At all.
And the sitcom, but you could tell from the theater master, not even valued. Not right. even looked at. You know, they probably got a whiff of it somewhere and said, oh, no. How could it possibly be good? So I can't even blame that guy because look at how they do it there.
Right.
I think he would even say, look how they do it here and wouldn't like it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's no quality is not a given. And the fact that, you know, you succeeded with the show doesn't necessarily mean that every sitcom that's coming out is worth watching. I think you made a comment the other night about one particular sitcom, but, you know,
but in Russia,
there are plenty of bad sitcoms.
In Russia and America.
Yeah.
It's just not unique to Russia. In fact, the point of the movie is, I would have loved to have said, oh, those Russians, but it wasn't those Russians. It was those executives.
Yeah.
And they happen to be the same wherever you go.
So did you butt heads with executives before you were a showrunner? Or that?
Of course.
A writer, you...
Of course. There's no way around it. Their job is kind of to say no to you.
Mm-hmm. So how was that for you?
Terrible. I never liked conflict. Who likes it? Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, I don't like there were times I quit my show. I quit my show twice before we got on the air. Hmm. Because, not because I'm so holy.
Right.
It's because I'm writing about my life. Now, there are compromises to make in every situation, mm-hmm. but you can't tell me that what I wrote isn't right. It really happened to me, and this is how it is, and this is how it needs to be. Mm. Otherwise, I have no show. If I capitulate and do it your way, then I've compromised this too much, and I know better than you, in this instance, what will work and what won't. Because I've seen it work in life. It's already proven to me that it works, that it's actually funny, and you can't tell me that you know better about my life. It's just that simple. In this case.
Was it a good thing that you ended up waiting until your late 30s to be in that position where it was your show?
I would say it was in my early 30s.
In your early 30s.
Yeah, that seems to be the right time. Because you're still young enough to have to stay up late. Although we never did. We were home for dinner every night. That was part of the job. Mm-hmm. If you worked for me, your job was to go home, get in a fight with your wife, and come back in and tell me about it. So that was that. Having dinner at home was very important, and I worked on many shows where having dinner at home was not important to the guy running the show, and you were there till 3 a.m. I didn't like that. No show ever got better at 3 a.m. You just think it did because you're punchy and you're loopy from the candy on the table.
Do you give advice to young kids coming up these days?
I do, whether they want it or not. I corner them and I grab them and I say, "You listen to me, young man."
Did you have anybody doing that for you?
No. I learned from example. In other words, I would work for people and then, like, here's a thing I didn't want to do. There was a memo sent around one office that I worked in. We noticed that some of you are putting milk on your cereal in the morning from the office kitchen. We do not provide breakfast for you. The milk is for coffee, the cereal is for a snack. Please do not put milk on your cereal. Okay, so I actually remember thinking, if I ever am lucky enough to have my own show, we're going to have milk on the cereal. And we did.
And they're spending $1.4 million a half hour.
You got it.
And they can't put milk on the cereal.
Milk on the cereal. That's what we're talking about. The show, by the way, stinks, but nobody's having milk on the cereal.
Have you, either since Raymond or in the process of it, did you meet up with people who were... I know the Gary Marshalls of the world, the people who have been doing this for 20, 30 years.
It's my favorite thing to do is to go out with my buddies now, Carl Reiner and Norman Lear, and these great people who have taken me under their wing, kind of. And now they're my friends, and I love them. I mean, it's the greatest thing. I organize lunches. I organize dinners just so I can be with them.
Do you have a sense that it changed, or has it... I mean, obviously the politics have changed over the years and Norman was pushing certain things and
absolutely.
Other people weren't, but has the business of doing what you do changed over that time?
Of course, it's gotten much worse. I mean, you couldn't get On the Family on the air today. They would say, well, you can't say those things. You can't deal with abortion on TV, right?
Well, but then Married with Children came along and, I mean, did it in a different way, but it was... I always think that every time we think that you can't do something, that somebody comes along and does it.
But it's very, very hard to get to break through like that.
Yeah.
Right? By the way, I don't think we could have gotten on. It was hard to get on then because it wasn't sexy enough. Mm-hmm. You know, what's the pitch?
You need a costumer from Russia.
Yes. The pitch is... A guy and his family live across the street from his parents. Nobody's jumping up and down. Oh my God, we got to have that show. How hot is that sounding?
But you guys created your own genre, really. I mean,
no,
in a way.
No, no.
But all those shows, Kings of Queens, and all those shows kind of got built up around you guys.
That's only because when something hits, everybody tries to imitate.
Right.
Okay, but we certainly didn't create the family sitcom.
No. But
we were trying to emulate the great ones that came before us.
We revived the family sitcom, I guess.
Absolutely. There'd been kind of a break between the Cosby Show of the 80s and our show. It was a pretty long break. Mm-hmm. And then there was kind of a long break between our show and Modern Family, but there it is.
Yeah.
You know, and Modern Family literally is modern. You know, you see what's going on there, all this stuff that maybe we wouldn't have been allowed to do then. They are allowed to do now. And not only are they allowed to do it, that's now the model. Mm-hmm. So much so that if we came back, they probably wouldn't want us anymore because we're too ordinary looking.
Until the model comes back around.
Maybe.
I mean, there are people who hate that model. I guess it started with The Office, really, in England even, not really here. the whole speaking to camera and breaking the fourth wall thing.
Yes, yes. And I've had enough of that, you know, talking to camera. Right. There are certain shows where I feel like you don't need it anymore. It's a little bit of a crutch.
Right.
And I think if they just went ahead and just did the story, but people love the characters and they're involved. They don't need to be talked to.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it helps in the writing as a shortcut. Well, just tell them what you feel. Then you don't have to demonstrate it.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah. So this movie feels a little like a showreel for you, for your next career as Raymond, as the Phil.
It wasn't the idea. I was not thinking about it at all. I was honestly, what you see in the movie is 100% real. And I realized that. I'm not an idiot. I knew I would be on camera. But you have to forget about being on camera.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm talking to you now, and you do have to, you know, I see it there. I see it. But if I'm going to be a good interview or right. be good at what being on camera, and I guess being a good actor,
mm-hmm.
you can't think about that. You have right. to connect with the person. So otherwise, you're not doing your job. And the truth is, after a couple of hours, I'd say at the most,
right.
you forget about the camera. By the way, in the movie, you see my parents, okay? They're not used to being filmed. Two guys came into their house where they've lived for 40 years with big cameras and lights. Another mm-hmm. guy with a boom mic. Within 5 minutes, they're fighting as if nobody's there.
Five minutes.
I mean, you see me laughing in the yeah. movie because I'm getting this stuff immediately. Immediately. They just turned it on.
So do you like the idea? Did you, in retrospect,
yeah.
having made a film,
yeah.
having directed like having written,
yeah.
Do you like the idea? Is it something that appeals to you as the next step in your life, or are you looking for the next sitcom to do?
It's all fun and it's all connected. To me, I love the business, except the business. I love doing it all. I really do. There's every, because maybe I was trained in all the disciplines, I love the writing, the directing, the producing, and the acting. It's all a different side of the same thing. All mm-hmm. branches off the same tree, right?
Right.
And that's why my advice is to anybody watching, you want to strengthen all the branches. You make the tree stronger.
But how do you move forward? I mean, do you wait for something to come to you? Do you have a moment of epiphany?
I think for acting, if somebody yeah. wanted to put me in something, and I'm on 30 Rock tonight, by the way.
Oh,
yeah. Tina Fey wrote to me and asked, would you like to be on?
It's great.
So I said, okay. I had a ball. It's mm-hmm. so much fun. And people have had Larry David put me in Curb one mm-hmm. episode. Jim Brooks put me in a movie in a little thing. And mm-hmm. I did a voice on the Simpsons movie in another thing. It's so much fun. By the way, I did the one line in the Simpsons movie.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end, the credit comes. They were nice enough to put everybody's credit and then the picture of the character that they voiced in the right. film. I was sitting next to my 12-year-old at the time who turned to me and said, finally, you've done something I can be proud of.
Oh, the cruelty of children.
You, as a dad, though, you take it where you can.
There you go. But, I mean, so do you wait for Tina to call or for...
I do.
Because ultimately you have to be, to create a sitcom like Raymond or something, you have to generate something.
The reason I didn't pursue acting is because, honestly, I couldn't handle it. I couldn't. It's just too hard on the soul for me.
The rejection or the work itself?
A little of both, I think. But mainly the rejection. It was so impossible. I don't know. I give 1,000% credit to guys who stick it out, people who can do it, you know? I really couldn't stomach it. It made me physically ill to have to go and audition up against so many people. It makes me nervous. Yeah. So, if Tina
calls... That would make you sane, by the way.
If Tina calls again, happy to go.
Mm-hmm.
It couldn't be easier to get a job that way by having right. someone nice see you in something and say, hey, come over here.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I realize that's a very lucky position to be in.
Yeah.
But then again, I'm not pursuing it so much. So if it happens, great. If not, I do have my day job.
So, do you have your day job? What do you...
Oh, I'm working on a million things. My joke is that I'm working on a million things that are in various stages of nothing's happening. Because everything takes so long, you know? But I actually have two screenplays out there that I'm going to direct.
Mm-hmm.
I have an animated presentation that I'm working on right now for a series.
Mm-hmm.
I have a show for England that I'm working on. I have a Broadway show idea that I'm working on. So many things.
And for the movies, that would be a different experience for you to actually be able to focus on directing rather than writing constantly through the process.
Yeah.
That sounds like it would be very exciting for
you. It seems more fun. Actual physically doing stuff to me is more fun than the writing.
Mm.
Yeah. But I can't say I don't enjoy writing when it's done.
Right.
it's just hard doing it.
So wherever the flag goes up first, the green light goes, that's
it's where actually you're... the project. It depends on the project.
But the projects you've chosen to be part of already, it sounds like.
Yes, and you want to see them through. You start on something, you want to follow through. You want to see it. Why bother if it's not going to see the light of day? You want everything you write and everything you're working on and care about to get out there. That's why we do it.
Is there such thing as having too much work?
Of course. Of course. Yes. But I work very hard to make sure that I'm going to have something that I love doing.
And so you're loving it still?
I do. Yeah, I love it.
Just get better, or is it get the same, or?
No, business is worse now.
Business is worse.
Yes, the toughness of actually getting the work out there is crazy. You know, like this movie, for example. Yeah. It's a little movie. Everyone we show it to seems to like it. It's really nice.
Yeah.
But I would bet that 90% of your audience right now has never heard of the movie. Why? Because it's not Avatar. Because it doesn't have a budget.
Right.
We're depending on sites like yours and tweeting and twitting and twatting and whatever else they do to get out there. Because that's now the way. The nice thing is that you can now have your trailer, for example, be seen by millions more people than would ever have seen it in the theater 10 years ago.
Right.
Before the link to the trailer was possible on everyone's phone and computer.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty cool.
But you seem your happiest in the movie, I think, when you finally connect with some of the guys in the Russian team and feel like you're actually being heard and you're actually doing the work.
I think as human beings on the planet, we want to connect with another person. So it really comes down to that basic need to be connected to someone else and to get to let them see what you have to offer and to see what they have to offer and make a friendship and make something. Mm-hmm. You know, that's really what it's all about. That's, I think, why people go into the arts at all, to have that connection with other people.
Yeah. And have you ever actually met Phil Rosenthal in Chicago?
I have. He called me once years ago and he goes, I write for the Chicago Sun-Times, I think it was.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to do a story on how we have the same name. I said, this must be a very slow news day over there. And so I met him for lunch. And you find yourself in the position of sitting at the table waiting for the other you to come in.
Mm-hmm.
Very weird. I said, I hope I'm the cuter one.
And were you?
You'd have to ask the waitress.